bringing the people behind our food to life.
It struck me, all of the financial upheaval, so much of it's based on illusionary numbers in the first place.
The way that the economy works normally, not in times of these sort of bubbles, but the everyday operation of the economy, also hides value. And that's why I think it's important to bring it back to issues like food, for example. I mean, in the book I talk about this $200 hamburger, about why if we were to value the environmental destruction behind the production of a hamburger, if we were to value, you know, the ecosystemic services that are lost when you chop down a rainforest to put soy plantations or to have pasture or whatever it is for your hamburger. If you put a dollar value on the biodiversity that you lose, if you put a dollar value on the carbon that is lost when you destroy the forest, on the oxygen that is not being produced for the atmosphere, when you put a dollar value to all that, a $4 hamburger actually ends up costing all of us, costing the earth, $200. But it's not a sum that we pay now. I mean, someone pays that sum. I mean, make no mistake. It's just not, it's not there in the price tag, and that's just one part of what is hidden when the economy operates normally, and that's something that we need to be aware of, I think.
Reading your book, it struck me that some people may be surprised that there's nothing free about the free market system. So share your thinking about markets focused on profits instead of needs as that faulty prism that you talk about, especially as it relates to food and agriculture, that we look at the market and it's not real what we see, right?
Right, exactly. I mean, one of the arguments I make in the book is that cheap food, I mean, let's stick with this hamburger, for example. I mean, the hamburger appears cheap because it cheats. Cheap food is cheat food. Let me give you an example. I mean, you know, let's take that hamburger a little step further. The tomatoes in that hamburger, if they're consumed in the United States in the winter, for example, then there's a strong chance that those tomatoes will come from southern Florida. And in the book, I talk about the conditions of modern slavery that exist in southern Florida. Since 1997, over 1,000 slaves have been freed from southern Florida, from appalling conditions of human rights abuses, of violence, of being forced into utterly degrading conditions. And they are paid pennies for the work that they do of picking tomatoes. Now, that's not a cost that appears in the food. And similarly, you know, all the way up the food chain, there are costs that are squeezed out to give us our $4 hamburger. And even then, that doesn't include the costs that happen afterwards. When, for example, that hamburger that hamburger may lead to obesity. It may lead to a range of diseases. Here in the United States, we have a diabetes rate of, well, if a child was born in 2000, one in three children will develop diabetes. One in two minority children will develop diabetes. And at the moment, one in five of our healthcare dollars is spent fighting diabetes or caring for someone with diabetes. And that's an incredible amount. I mean, and we're paying that right now. That's hidden from us in that $4 cost. And of course, the way that we consume today in general has a huge cost in developing countries. If we were to add up the cost of our consumption over the past 40 years, as some researchers did recently, we owe developing countries $4 to $5-6 trillion, depending on how you do the sums. And again, that we don't pay that, they pay that, but that's a cost that is getting paid, that's being cheated out of our food system by the way our corporations are behaving.